When most people my age think of the word machinima, the first thing that comes to our minds is probably the defunct multimedia internet company Machinima Inc., which was one of the first and biggest gaming content creation-centered networks on the internet in the late 2000s and early 2010s, before painfully imploding on itself in the mid to late 2010s. But the word machinima itself comes from, well, machinimas, which were cinematic productions created through the use of pre-existing computer graphic engines, most notably video games. In 1996, following their smash hit 1993 game Doom, developer id Software released their next killer app, Quake. What made Quake stand out from the likes of Doom was that it actually used real 3D graphics, had an innovative team deathmatch approach to its game design, and had an online multiplayer feature at its launch. But one thing that Doom and Quake shared in common was that both had an option where you can record and playback sequences in real time. However, due to its 3D graphics and advanced customizations, Quake's machinima feature was more preferable to use. And by the time Quake came out, the internet was still fairly new to consumers. But with Quake's machinima features, you can not only export your playback sequences, but you can also upload these little clips onto the internet. Though this of course is no big deal today. Back then, being able to upload a video to the then fairly new internet must have been a pretty revolutionary feature for the time. People would of course use these machinima features in different ways, such as the speedrunning community, which we all know today being founded on speedrun clips of Quake levels via the use of machinimas, most notably on the website Speed Demos Archive, which began as a Quake speedrunning website and soon turned into the hub of all speedrunning content on the internet. But some people use these machinima features in Quake for different reasons. The same year that Quake came out, the well-known gaming clan The Rangers released a 1.5-minute short film made entirely with Quake's machinima features called Diary of a Camper. Though it's anything from spectacular today, back then there was nothing like Diary of a Camper that came out before it. Diary of a Camper wasn't technically the first machinima in internet history, but it was the first that made the most impact upon its initial 1996 release, which inspired many other quote-unquote Quake movies, which was what machinimas were called at the time until 1998 when the name was changed by combining the words machine and cinema together into, well, machinima. Further, machinimas of the time would also use digital video editing to increase the production value of their short films, like including voice acting and music.
Think about your family! Think about what they mean to you! Blah blah blah! Blah blah blah!
These machinima features would carry on into the next installments of the Quake franchise, Quake 2 and Quake 3 Arena to be specific. But these sort of machinima features were also included in many other first-person shooter games of the era, like Unreal Tournament, Half-Life, and Counter-Strike. But all these games were only exclusive to PC gamers. What about those who played on console? On November 15th, 2001, computer software company Microsoft officially entered into the video game market by releasing their first home video game console, the Xbox. And with it came one of the most defining and innovative launch titles in video game history, that being Halo Combat Evolved. Like with Quake before it, Halo had a team deathmatch design when it came to its local multiplayer. But unlike Quake, you couldn't record or save a multiplayer sequence in-game. However, some people found a way around this. In the late 90s and early 2000s, it was discovered that if you plug either a VHS, DVD, or capture card into the console, you could record gameplay directly from the console, and then export it to a computer where you could then further edit your gameplay footage and release it to the internet. And this was a necessity in creating Halo machinimas. But for a while, nobody really attempted to make a Halo machinima because of all these hurdles, compared to the machinimas made in PC games of the time. But on April 1st, 2003, independent media company Rooster Teeth, headed by Bernie Burns, would release the first Halo machinima, Red vs. Blue, arguably the most well-known and successful machinima series of all time. Red vs. Blue would go on to not only be one of the most successful machinimas of its day, but it also became one of the most popular web series of that time, and launched Rooster Teeth into superstardom on the internet. In 2004, Bungie, the developers of Halo, would release their highly anticipated sequel, Halo 2, which was not only one of the first major online multiplayer games on a home console via that of Xbox Live, but it also greatly improved upon Halo 1's movie-making abilities. By Halo 2 having a traditional machinima feature that allowed gamers to record and play back their online multiplayer sessions. And in 2007, Bungie would release the third and final installment in the original Halo trilogy, Halo 3, which had even more features when it came to its machinima capabilities. Most notably, having the famous Forge mode, which allowed players to make custom maps and invite online players to play on said maps. In its early seasons, Red vs. Blue was strictly a comedy-style show, due to the limitations of Halo 1. But with Halo 2 and 3's machinima features, and in combination with traditional 3D animated action sequences, Red vs. Blue would start to tell a serialized story that continued on for many seasons, with many fans agreeing that Season 13 was Red vs. Blue's true ending. With the success of Red vs. Blue, many other creative minds on the internet were inspired by that of Rooster Teeth to create their very own machinimas. While most blatantly copied that of Red vs. Blue, by setting their machinimas in the Halo games and emulating Rooster Teeth's style of comedy, there were of course others that tried something different and made machinimas in other popular video games. In 2005, the then final installment of the Star Wars film franchise was released, which was Star Wars Episode III: Revenge of the Sith, and with it came the release of many tie-in video games by LucasArts. But the most impactful of these games would of course be Star Wars Battlefront 2, which was released on October 31st, 2005, for the original Xbox, PlayStation 2, and PC respectively. It instantly became a smash hit overnight, and further grew to become one of the most defining first-person shooter games of the sixth generation of gaming, due to its story mode, which chronicled the 501st Legion's descent into the Empire, and its fun and open-style gameplay that made players feel like they were playing in the films themselves. While it may not have the competitive balancing that Halo had, Star Wars Battlefront 2 was fun, and I can't even begin to recall the amount of hours I had as a kid just playing this game. There was truly no game at the time that was as advanced as Battlefront 2. In its customization, large and open maps, game modes, intricate space combat, and fun Easter eggs and references that made the game not only technically impressive, but also just extremely enjoyable in general. And I was of course not alone on this, as in 2010, Microsoft would officially announce they would be discontinuing Xbox Live on the original Xbox, which meant that all Xbox Live multiplayer games that were only released on the original Xbox would have their online multiplayer modes discontinued. On April 15th, 2010, Microsoft would officially discontinue Xbox Live for the original Xbox, with Microsoft themselves revealing that Star Wars Battlefront 2 had the second largest Xbox Live player base on the platform, behind that of Halo 2 of course, which just goes to show you how big the player base was at the time. On the PC side of things, on February 22nd, 2006, developer Pandemic Studios and publisher LucasArts released the official modding tools so that modders could create their own custom maps, game assets, 3D models, and custom characters and skins. Battlefront 2's modding community became one of the most popular of the modding scenes in the mid to late 2000s, and would even continue into the 2010s, where it still maintains a loyal modding community to this day. The point I'm trying to make here is that even though Battlefront 2 maybe hasn't aged well in terms of gameplay, balancing, or graphics, it still maintained one of the biggest fan bases that a game from its era has ever achieved, mostly due to people my age or older who grew up with this game and have extreme nostalgia towards it. But another thing that people my age or older have nostalgia for are classic machinimas. But what if I told you that there was a machinima series that was made in Star Wars Battlefront 2 that was released in the late 2000s and early 2010s? This series went on for 3 episodes and continued to 5 more, making it a one-season machinima that was planned to continue for a second season, but this second season never came to be, and for almost a decade, fans of this machinima have been waiting for the series to continue. But in the span of this decade, barely any news has come out about its whereabouts. This is the story of a clone apart, the best machinima series that never was. Our journey begins in the year 2001, where brothers Ryan and Jeffrey James founded an independent film and video game media-centered company called Illusive Entertainment, with their childhood friend Mike Robinson. And just to interject for a second, for the most part, I couldn't find any pictures of these guys. So for this documentary, I'm going to be representing these people as character models from Battlefront 2 directly, so sorry in advance. Anyways, Ryan was into filmmaking, and wanted to be a director slash screenwriter ever since he was a kid, while Mike and Jeffrey were into creating their own video games. In the summer of 2001, Illusive Entertainment would launch their own website, with the earliest known archive screenshot appearing in mid-2002. In July of 2001, Illusive Entertainment would begin development on their first game called Urban Jungle. Urban Jungle was set to be a third-person online multiplayer arena shooter game that thrusted players into a randomly generated city where they would fight each other to compete for resources and weaponry, with the game graphics and mechanics being inspired by Grand Theft Auto 3 and Postal 2, or at least judging by these blurry screenshots they were. Illusive Entertainment also hoped for this game to become a multi-platform title that would be released on the original Xbox, PS2, and GameCube respectively. Illusive Entertainment would set up a team to create this game, aptly titled the Urban Jungle Team, for which there were only a handful of members who, like Ryan, Jeffrey, and Mike, also went to UC San Diego. For the rest of 2001, they would continue working on the game, and by 2002, Illusive Entertainment were so confident in their prototype that they wanted to present it at E3, the annual gaming expo that holds not only the industry professional game demos and teasers, but also independent games from independent studios, sometimes at least. However, on New Year's Eve 2002, Illusive Entertainment would announce that they would be putting Urban Jungle on hold, which they promised they would continue at the time. But by 2004, they would stop production on Urban Jungle indefinitely, citing it as a project too big for their own good, with them jokingly labeling it a dust collector. But the good that came from Urban Jungle's development was the amount of advanced experience with game mechanics that its fairly new team would acquire, as well as Illusive Entertainment garnering attention at E3, and getting several contacts to the video game industry, which would definitely help in their future endeavors. Around this time in 2004, Illusive Entertainment began work on their next game, OMFG Jericho, which was set to be a Sims-like game set in a classic Futurama-type science fiction spaceship setting, which, long story short, never really got off the ground. In the meantime, though, Ryan would make and release his first feature film called Real, which was released in 2005, and had a budget of $25,000, and had a runtime of 104 minutes, with him premiering it at local San Diego private screenings and film festivals. But also around this time, Ryan would begin his unofficial start in the professional games industry, with him being a playtester for Pandemic Studios' 2004 game Star Wars Battlefront. In a behind-the-cinematic interview conducted by Billy Calisti, Ryan James recalls how he got the job in becoming a playtester for Battlefront 1, saying, "So I made a movie that I wrote myself coming out of college. I had in previous summers tried to intern at this game studio, Pandemic Studios. And the internship didn't work out for, I can't even remember what reason. But the person who was in charge of that remembered me and we were kind of friends and maintained that relationship. And so when I was finally out of college and working in post on this film, he said, well, while you're doing that, why don't you become a video game tester part-time here on Battlefront 1? We need people and there's no harm in you working while you're doing post on your things. So I took him up on that, and I've always loved video games too, and I wanted to make one. When Pandemic Studios finished Battlefront 1, they would of course start work on the sequel, Battlefront 2, to coincide with the DVD release date for Revenge of the Sith. One of the biggest advancements that Battlefront 2 made from its predecessor was that this game would have a story mode, as the previous installment barely had one. This new campaign for Star Wars Battlefront 2 followed the journey of a clone trooper in the 501st Battalion, and its eventual downfall into the Imperial Army, with the journal narrations for which the story is primarily told being voiced by Tamara Morrison, the same actor who played Jango Fett and all of the clone troopers in the Star Wars prequels. The The campaign for Battlefront 2 would also require the use of cutscenes, but the problem was that Pandemic Studios didn't have enough time to construct their own animated cutscenes. So they would have no choice but to use Machinima-like techniques to create their cutscenes that played during the campaign mode. So when Ryan began playtesting for Battlefront 2, knowing that Ryan had a background in filmmaking, Pandemic Studios would approach Ryan to do the Machinima cutscenes for Battlefront 2. As Ryan recalls, "I started as a tester on Battlefront 1, and then for the second one. While I was a tester, there was a difference. Instead of being a tester in just the QA room, there was a contract with LucasArts where I was in internal QA, with just four other guys who were in there with a more direct conduit to the devs, and they needed someone to make all the little cutscenes that happened in the story mode. So they knew that I had a film background. They asked if I wanted to do that, which was great for them because they got cinematics on a tester salary. But I gotta figure how to have them make all these tools for me. I had different types of cameras that could tether to the vehicles and stuff like that." So essentially, Ryan got paid to make official machinimas for Battlefront 2 that would be featured in the final game. After work on Battlefront 2 finished, Ryan would still do work for Pandemic Studios, mostly editing trailers for their upcoming games, as well as doing similar machinima cutscenes for the game Mercenaries 2 World in Flames. During his free time while making these machinima cutscenes, Ryan as well as his brother Jeffrey would grow accustomed to the exclusive machinima tools that Pandemic Studios personally made for them. And in their free time, both Ryan and Jeffrey would start to experiment making their own stories within the machinimas that they were already crafting. At the same time that Ryan and Jeffrey were making these machinimas, Red vs. Blue was making rounds across the internet. And with this new inspiration, Ryan and Jeffrey decided to make their own little machinima series. Ryan and Jeffrey were huge fans of the original Star Wars trilogy as kids. And like many who grew up with these films in the 80s, they too were disappointed in the newer prequel trilogy. One thing that they didn't like in particular was that the prequels had many continuity errors that didn't match to the story elements in the original trilogy. Like the midichlorians, the overall character of Anakin Skywalker himself, and more specifically, the presentation of the clone army. In the original Star Wars trilogy, the Empire Stormtrooper army was composed of what seemed to be either voluntary recruits, or drafted civilians forced into carrying out the deeds of the Empire's galactic dictatorship. However, in the prequels, more specifically Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, revealed that the Empire Stormtroopers were once clone troopers that fought for the Galactic Republic, that were clones from the Mandalorian bounty hunter Jango Fett, and were all secretly controlled by Emperor Palpatine to wipe out the Jedi Council to start the Galactic Empire. This doesn't really make any sense in the film's context, since in the original films, all the stormtroopers had different voices.
"Do you know what's going on? Maybe it's another drill."
And the Imperial officers and generals also look different from one another. However, in the campaign for Star Wars Battlefront 2, it's revealed that after the 501st Legion becomes part of the Imperial Army, the planet of Kamino, you know, the planet for which the clone army was created on, decides to create a new batch of rogue clone troopers but are eliminated by the 501st Legion, for which it's decided by the Empire that they will no longer be using clones in the Imperial Army, and will instead be recruits or drafts forced into serving in the Imperial Army, for which the remaining clone troopers, like that of the surviving 501st Legion, would still serve under the Empire, until its fall to the rebels at the end of Return of the Jedi. But again, all this stuff I just said was never explained in the movies, and was only explained in Battlefront 2 and other expanded universe lore that was released at the time. Ryan and Jeffrey's machinima sought to bridge the gap between the prequel and the original trilogy, in terms of this clone paradox of sorts. As Ryan recalls, "We spent many lunches during crunch time at work talking about it, until we hit upon something. We'd never seen time travel in the Star Wars universe. And with all that in the ether, suddenly it clicked. We could take a lone, awkward clone and transport him to the present of the original trilogy, and let hilarity ensue. Our clone would be adept at pointing out everything that just didn't add up, as well as anything silly about the universe. The game engine we filmed it in, whatever we wanted. After that, ideas just kept piling and piling together. Ryan and Jeffrey presumably started working on the series in mid-2005, and used the modified developer kit version of Battlefront 2. It's unknown what port of the game they used, but on their old FAQ forum on the Illusive Entertainment website, Ryan states that they used the developer modified version of the original Xbox port of the game. Ryan and Jeffrey then had to record what scenes they needed, and had to customize the loadout for each map as desired. In Battlefront 2, there are only two eras of warfare that you can play in. The Clone Wars, where you can either play as the Republic or the Federation, and the Galactic Civil War, where you play as either the Empire or the Rebellion, for which you can't combine these eras and mix up said armies together. For example, you can't have the Empire fighting against the Republic, and you can't have all four of these armies in the same game lobby, if that makes any sense. This is where the modified developer copy of Battlefront 2 came in handy, as with this copy, they could have the Empire army in the same lobby as the Republic army, which was important for the story of Ryan and Jeffrey's Machinima, since it was about a clone trooper traversing with stormtroopers for most of the plot. In their free time, they edited the character loadouts for each level, and then used the various in-game engine camera tools to frame all the visuals, recording all the footage to a computer. Apparently when they started, Ryan and Jeffrey didn't even have a script when they were filming the first episode, and were going off of an outline for the basic plot. Unlike a live-action series production, in which you have to write, then record, then assemble your project in that exact order, a machinima can be recorded without even writing your script. And for Ryan and Jeffrey, that's what they did, or at least that's what they said they did. They would go into Battlefront 2 and record the clone troopers bobbing their heads over and over again to simulate them talking, but to my knowledge, they only did this for the dialogue-focused scenes, and all the action set pieces were already planned out. In post-production, Ryan and Jeffrey would then write the script for the first episode, and in editing, they would edit the clone troopers bobbing their heads to the recorded dialogue of the script. For the dialogue itself, Jeffrey would voice the main protagonist dancing Delta 40, and friend of Jeff's, John Fritz, would voice the character of Biff Gamma 09, Alpha 12, and the other assorted clones and stormtroopers in the background. A friend of Ryan's, Whitney Barron, would voice the character of Percy Scout Beta 266, and the character of Rook. In a 2013 interview with Forrest Bizote, Ryan describes Barron as, "He naturally has a very long-winded, verbose way of speaking, so we decided to have him voice the character and amp things up. Whitney never sounds quite like that, but the gist was inspired by him." Barron would also join Ryan and Jeff to be an additional writer, for which he would hold that position till the end of the series. In the second episode, Ryan would voice the character Teflon McBomb as well as the other Imperial background characters. Ryan states that the inspiration for Teflon McBomb comes from two places. One, a Scottish accent is one of the only ones I feel I can do passably well, though for the series I purposely make it over the top. Second, I knew a guy in college who played an RPG character named Tic Tac that always liked to blow things up, no matter what circumstance. And when we realized, to keep the characters distinct, that we had to use a rocket trooper class for the character, we looked at the bazooka he always carries and said, why not make him like Tic Tac? Ryan's own wife, Yvonne Yao, would voice the character of Colonel Vespa, as well as many of the other female voices in the Machinima. Sometime in 2006, Illusive Entertainment would finish the first episode for their Battlefront 2 Machinima, and on August 11, 2006, Illusive Entertainment would officially release their Machinima and post it to the internet, with their Machinima being titled Star Wars: A Clone Apart. The first episode begins with the titular Star Wars title crawl, stating that our story begins sometime during Revenge of the Sith. We then cut to a Republic gunship descending on the planet Kamino, the home of the clones. We then cut to our main protagonist dancing Delta 40, admiring the reign of Kamino, which becomes a recurring joke throughout the series. In the scene ripped straight out of Red vs. Blue, Danson and his fellow clone trooper friend Biff debate the true purpose of their existence.
It's as if each has its own destiny and purpose, like we do.
What? Delta 40. We're clones in the Republic Army. We're all here for the same reason. To serve and fight and die.
Do you really think that's all we're here for? That's all there is to it?
Definitely.
We then jump to Scout and Alpha 12 discussing the new batch of clone troopers, for which it's revealed that because the Galactic Republic was running out of clone troopers during the Clone Wars, Kamino had to rush a new batch of Delta clone troopers, for which Danson is the only surviving member of this batch, as the rest died in the cloning process. Because of the rushed Delta batch of clone troopers, Danson has a different height and voice from the rest of the clone troopers. Other batches of clones also have different voices for this issue also. I'm guessing this whole clone batch subplot is to explain why stormtroopers in the original trilogy all had different voices, or to just poke fun at the prequels even more. Alpha 12 then comes out to command the clone trooper squad to hop onto the Republic command ship, for which they are given orders by a hologram of a clone captain to battle on the planet Utapau, to fight alongside Obi-Wan Kenobi in the capture of General Grievous. But the clone troopers won't be helping Obi-Wan, as their unit is responsible for obtaining stolen power crystals. However, before the hologram clone captain is done with his instructions, Danson blasts the hologram by mistake. After that scene, we cut to the clone troopers in the hangar about to get onto the Republic gunship.
What do you want, soldier?
Sir, why is this trash can dancing?
It's a blasted ammunition droid, you nitwit. Didn't you learn about that in basic training?
Anyways, Danson and company get aboard the gunship and fly down to the Battle of Utapau. Once on Utapau, the clones start battling with the droid army, to which Danson has no idea what he's doing. Danson soon gets into a Republic walker, to which he has no idea how to control it.
I'll just press the green button. Aha! Green means go! Okay, green means backward! Blue! Oh, sorry about that! I hope it'll be okay. Now, let's go to the left. Oops, back into the left. No, back into the left. Damn you, cheap contract labor!
But eventually, a battle droid shoots Danson's walker down with a rocket launcher, forcing Danson to run aimlessly into the battlefield. Danson then meets up with Biff, where he reveals that he's run out of ammo, for which Biff shoots a fellow clone trooper to get more ammo for Danson's rifle. But right after, it's revealed that Danson had his rifle on safety the whole time.
Oh wait, I just had the safety on! Problem solved! Wait, let me get it from my rocket, yes, ammo!
We then cut to Alpha 12 and the fighter tank shooting at the battle droids, until they approach the generator with the power crystals. But instead of disabling the generator like they were instructed, Alpha 12 then destroys the generator, with the destroyed crystals shooting a vortex-like portal right in front of Danson. A droidica then approaches and tries to shoot Danson with its blaster arms, with Danson having no choice but to jump into the vortex. The vortex then teleports Danson into what seems to be an empty spaceship. But when Danson exits the room of the ship, it's revealed that he has been teleported 20 years into the future on the Tanith IV, in the first scene of A New Hope when the Empire invades the Rebel blockade runner. The first episode ends with a cliffhanger, as after this it cuts to the credits. And after the credits comes a teaser for the second episode. The second episode of A Clone Apart, titled New Time, New Place, starts off right where the episode 1 left off, with Danson on the Rebel blockade runner at the beginning of A New Hope. While walking around the blockade runner, Danson runs into Biff, who's now a stormtrooper.
Danson? What are you doing here? It's only me, Biff. Come out already and enjoy the stale, reprocessed air of this Rebel blockade runner with me.
Biff then explains to Danson that he's been missing for the last 20 years.
It's not hell, Danson. Well, it is, but not like you think. You've been missing for 20 years. This is the future. For you, I guess. Huh.
They then run into the character of Teflon McBomb, who misfires a shot from his rocket launcher and nearly killing Danson and Biff.
Oops. Sorry about that, Shint. Good thing it was a warning shot, eh?
Marine! You want to tell me what in you were thinking? Firing off explosive ammunition that could have blown a hole in the ship and let us all be sucked out into outer space?
You want to tell me why you tossed the first grenade when we stormed onto the ship, Biff with an H? Those are explosives too, you know.
The episode then cuts to Danson and Biff, who are now on a Star Destroyer, where Biff introduces Danson to all the Empire's new technology.
Wow, they really didn't do much to spruce up the place. No, they did. most of our technology now, it's not as round, clean, and smooth as before. Everything is about angles. And rust. Curves are very passé.
Again, this segment is meant to mock the prequels. Danson and Biff then go to meet up with Scout, who is now dressed in the Scout Trooper uniform. Biff then explains to Danson about Kamino's rogue clone troopers, and why the Empire now recruits stormtroopers.
Anyway, there was a rebellion on Kamino. We had to kill our own brethren. Wow, clone against clone. But they couldn't have been as good as you guys. They were copies of me. No wonder you're still alive.
Yes, that's why we recruit now. The quality of clones was deteriorating rapidly.
You mean like me, right?
Yep.
Biff and Danson then meet up with Rook, a droid stormtrooper that has a jetpack and a puny little pistol.
But if you're such a lethal fighting machine that we're going to be reduced to mechanics, why do you only carry a wimpy pistol?
They do not trust me with anything more lethal. Audible sigh. It is humiliating.
The Star Destroyer then arrives at the Death Star, with Biff and company showing Danson around the new station. While on the Death Star, Rook asks for Danson's rifle, which becomes a running joke throughout the series.
Can I have your rifle?
No.
But I have had my eye on that large rifle of yours all afternoon. There must be a better way to say that.
Biff and Scout then take Danson to the detention center, where Danson is enrolling for the Imperial Army, and for him to get a new stormtrooper suit. As before, the Imperial droid guards mistakenly shot at Danson because he's still wearing his clone trooper armor. While in line, it turns out that Alpha 12 is behind the desk, shamefully enrolling fellow stormtroopers into the Empire. And that's where Episode 2 ends. Episode 3, titled Imperial Detail, picks up right after Episode 2. With Danson enrolling into the Imperial Army, with Danson learning that the Galactic Republic is now the Galactic Empire.
Wait, Imperial? What happened to the Army of the Grand Republic?
Oh, actually we call ourselves the Galactic Empire now.
Why?
Things are just different now. Mostly because of the war. There's no Jedi Council. I heard they just dissolved the Senate.
They also make fun of the idea of Imperial officers in relation to stormtroopers, with Alpha 12 now being delegated to work a desk job at the Death Star, instead of giving orders like he used to do back in the Clone Wars.
Where did these officer guys come from? We never had any unarmed.
They showed up out of nowhere just a few days after we were declared an empire, all trained and everything. I never even saw recruitment flyers.
Danson then takes a nap during the enrollment process, with the dream taking place on Kamino, but is then woken up by a self-destructing interrogation droid. When awoken, Danson is then ordered to join Biff and McBomb to go to the planet Tatooine, for Danson's first official mission for the Imperial Army. Scout and Rook are to remain on the Death Star, since Scout is only allowed to go on forest planets and Rook is to be kept a secret from the Rebel Alliance. Alpha 12 tries to join Danson and Biff onto the Tatooine mission, but is denied by his Imperial officer. The episode then cuts to Danson and Biff in Mos Eisley, where Biff reveals to Danson why he and Scout are still privates nearly 20 years later.
So, why are you still a private?
Soon after I was promoted to sergeant, one of the new recruits with a phony sounding accent made fun of my name, so I threw him in a trash compactor. There was no evidence, but Scout snitched on me, so I was demoted. Then they made a rule that clones could never be promoted again, so I'm still a private.
Wait, Scout snitched?
Claimed he was preventing an anger management episode.
But he hasn't been promoted either.
Nope. Apparently the Imperial Army has a general policy of punishing snitches.
A Jawa then appears in Danson's face, with Danson shooting the innocent Jawa.
What was that?
Wow! I forgot you still have that old blue laser rifle!
Oh, glowy eyes. Those terrible, terrible
eyes.
All
of ours fire red lasers now.
Biff, what was that thing?
Nothing. Just a Jawa. Local riffraff. I doubt there'll be much of a local response.
But I just murdered an innocent citizen.
They're not citizens! They're dirty little border jumpers with 14 kids to feed who sell other people's garbage for a living!
He had 14 kids? Oh.
Biff then decides to take Danson to the Mos Eisley Cantina to celebrate his first kill. But just moments before, Han Solo had just shot Greedo in the cantina, so two stormtroopers are guarding the doors, prohibiting anybody from entering the bar. But Biff finds a way to distract the two naive stormtroopers.
What happened?
There was some violent incidents. A crazy old hermit cut off someone's arm. and a suspected smuggler shot a Rodian. We're still inconclusive on who shot first.
Crazy old hermit. We just saw someone with that description heading off in the speeder headed for Tashi Station. If you hurry, you could possibly catch them in at... Oh wait, it probably wouldn't help you anyway.
What? What do you mean?
Are you guys clones?
Danson, shut it.
No. Of course not.
Oh. Never mind then. Oh, well, it's your lucky day then. If you catch them, since you're not clones, there could be a promotion in it for you.
Let's roll.
Great. Thanks. I really like that one trooper's armor. All the blue trimming. So stylish. Our armor is so soulless and boring.
That was too easy.
Imperial detail just isn't what it used to be.
Danson and Biff then enter the cantina, where the bartender reveals to Danson that the Imperial Army is a fascist regime. All of a sudden, Teflon McBomb then enters the cantina to interrogate the bartender of the recent activity that's been happening in his bar.
Now, it was you that allowed the customers in that caused this mess, wasn't it?
No, sir! That was my assistant word.
Don't lie to me, peon! You cannot fool the servants of the Imperial Arms so easily!
But...
The truth!
Well, I...
Come on!
But...
That's it! This will be a solo-run establishment from now on!
Don't kill me! I swear I didn't do anything.
All right now, lad. Don't get in a twist. I was only trying to make sure you were straight with me.
But after the interrogation, Teflon accidentally shoots the bartender and almost hits Danson and Biff, believing that his rocket launcher was on safety when it wasn't.
I could swear the safety latch is like this. Whoops, I guess now the safety's on. Now boys, where were we?
Danson and Biff then run out the bar and are then confronted with a gang of Jawas, which were family members of the Jawa that Danson accidentally killed, chasing Danson and Biff down, for which they decide to split up. While running from the Jawas, Danson enters Docking Bay 94 when the Millennium Falcon is taking off from Mos Eisley, with Danson interrupting the stormtroopers and shooting Han Solo. One of the stormtroopers who was guarding the bar doors then decides to snitch on Danson, where an Imperial officer then decides to discharge Danson for aiding in the escape of the Millennium Falcon.
Attention all units in Mos Eisley. I have just been informed of direct insubordination on Operation Find the Crazy, instigated by one Danson Delta 40.
The target escaped on a freighter of some kind. The details are still coming in.
Danson is to be apprehended immediately for termination, discharge, if possible.
Biff then gets the message of this and decides to find Danson, which he surely does, with Danson hiding in a trash pile. Biff then talks to Danson and suggests that he abandon the Imperial Army in fear that he may be court-martialed, and that Danson never really belonged in the army in the first place, with Biff suggesting to Danson that he finds where and what he truly belongs in.
So this is goodbye?
You don't belong here, Danson. You never did. It's time you try finding out where you do belong. So, since you're not going to be a soldier, can I have your rifle?
Why does everyone want my rifle? It doesn't even work!
User error, Danson. User error. Goodbye, Danson. May the Force be with you. And your rifle.
And like that, Danson and Biff go their separate ways, with the episode cutting on a cliffhanger when Boba Fett appears out of nowhere looking down upon Danson. And like that, episode 3 comes to a close. Episode 1 was released publicly on the internet on August 11, 2006, but it's unknown when episodes 2 and 3 were released. But we know for a fact that they were all released separately sometime in mid to late 2006. And the reason I say sometime in 2006 is because to this day, it's unknown when Illusive Entertainment released episodes 2 and 3 to the internet. But both the Internet Archive upload of the episode and the end credits of the episode itself state that it was released in 2006. Where it was probably released on YouTube, which was new at the time, and also their own website. And for why we can't just look at the original uploads of the episodes on YouTube itself to check the dates, well, we'll go over that in a second. But for the YouTube uploads, Illusive Entertainment would have to split up the 15 to 20 minute episodes into two halves, since at the time you could only upload videos under 10 minutes in length to YouTube. And for a year, A Clone Apart would barely garner any traction, although some forum users at the time, reposted the series. But sometime in 2007, a clone of parts started to gain traction on the internet, and according to Ryan, this is when the series blew up on YouTube. Though many of course labeled a clone of part as a red versus blue wannabe, others thought that the three episodes were really well made, especially for the time. At the time, there were many machinimas that were of course inspired by red versus blue, with some of these amateur machinimas having very poor production value. But a clone of parts stood out not only in the way it was edited, but also the fact that it wasn't just another Halo machinima, but was instead one that was told through the gameplay of Star Wars Battlefront 2. People also really liked the writing and how Ryan and Jeff poked fun at the Star Wars saga in general.
We wanted to wish you well, as is customary for a soldier when death is imminent.
You mean, you're not coming along?
Oh, no. Imperial Armory rules dictate that we scout troopers are only allowed on forested planets. It's been said that our lightweight armor wouldn't protect us against...
It's all the same plastic!
Although some of the writing definitely feels like direct riffs from Red vs. Blue's dialogue. Still though, A Clone Apart was a success for Illusive Entertainment, with not only their YouTube videos receiving positive feedback, but also their own dedicated website. But that same year in 2007, multimedia company Viacom would famously sue YouTube for over $1 billion, stating that YouTube was facilitating their users to steal copyrighted media and repost it to their site. And because of this, YouTube started to purge most of all users' copyrighted content on their platform, whether it was fair use or not, as YouTube would use their newly implemented content ID system to automatically flag and remove videos that had copyrighted material in them. Most of the copyrighted content that was removed from YouTube's platform were those that used music, movies, or TV shows in either their audio or their visuals. But surprisingly, video game related media content wasn't flagged, and historically this was why gaming content grew so much during this time. Well, as long as the gaming content didn't use music, movies, or TV shows for additional footage or audio. But unfortunately, A Clone Apart wasn't spared in YouTube's flagging of copyrighted videos, as sometime in 2007, all three of the episodes were deleted from their platform, even though the footage that Illusive Entertainment edited together was from the video game Star Wars Battlefront 2, the audio and more specifically the music was a completely different story. You see, instead of Pandemic Studios composing a new soundtrack for Battlefront 2, they just decided to use an arranged soundtrack from all six of the previous Star Wars film soundtracks that were all composed by John Williams, with these soundtracks being owned by Sony Music Entertainment at the time. Unlike the video game itself, the soundtrack for Battlefront 2 was probably the reason why A Clone Apart was copyright claimed and taken off of YouTube in 2007. At the time, there were rumors that Lucasfilm themselves sued Illusive Entertainment for A Clone Apart, and that was the real reason for why the episodes were taken off of YouTube, which is a rumor that persists to this very day, and is even listed on A Clone Apart's fan wiki. However, in a 2011 FAQ on Illusive Entertainment's website, Ryan states that the reason for why A Clone Apart was taken off of YouTube was because of the rampant content ID claims that arose when Viacom sued YouTube. And by 2007, when A Clone Apart blew up and was taken down by YouTube, Ryan and Jeff James were too busy working on the game Mercenaries 2, World in Flames, and had put A Clone Apart on hold until they finished it. Or at least I'm assuming that's what happened. And for the next 4 years, there were no updates on A Clone Apart's development from Illusive Entertainment.
Going up to 19. It's always a great view when you actually open up this elevator for the first time. That's right. We're going to Pandemic now, which is going to be a ghost town, unfortunately.
In February of 2009, Pandemic Studios, the developers of Star Wars Battlefront 2, as well as the current employers of Ryan and Jeff James, were bought by video game publisher Electronic Arts. And on November 17, 2009, EA would confirm Pandemic Studios' closure, laying off all 228 employees who worked there, including Ryan and Jeff. Many of these employees who worked for Pandemic Studios would go on to have careers at other prominent gaming studios, like 343 Industries, Treyarch, Infinity Ward, Respawn Entertainment, and many others. For Ryan James, he too would continue to have a career in video games, as Ryan was hired by famed video game developer Naughty Dog, who were well known for developing the original Crash Bandicoot and Jak and Daxter trilogy of games. By the time that Ryan joined Naughty Dog in early 2009, they were already working on the highly anticipated sequel Uncharted 2 Among Thieves. for which Ryan was assigned as both a dialogue editor and a trailer editor for the game. For the sequel, Uncharted 3, Drake's Deception, Ryan would be bumped as the editor of the game. Uncharted 3 would be released in 2011, but that same year, Illusive Entertainment would come back with the clone apart. In late August of 2011, Illusive Entertainment would repost the first three episodes of A Clone Apart to their website, labeling these new uploads as special editions, which are of course a reference to the infamous Star Wars special editions that were released in 1997, with George Lucas making even more baffling alterations to these films in the 2004 DVD and 2011 Blu-ray releases of the original trilogy. But unlike the special editions of the original trilogy, the special editions for A Clone Apart simply upscaled the footage, making the visuals of the gameplay higher quality than it was before, as well as making some changes in terms of the audio, most notably the trooper voiceovers, since this was the new audio setup that they would use for the remainder of the season.
Now what the heck am I supposed to do? I mean, what am I even doing here? Am I trying to get myself killed?
No, you're trying to die defending the Republic!
That's the same thing!
Just remember your training, son. You'll do fine. Good luck.
Now what the heck am I supposed to do? I mean, what am I even doing here? Am I trying to get myself killed?
No, you're trying to die defending the Republic.
That's the same thing.
Just remember your training, son. You'll do fine. Good luck.
As well as some minor trims and editing. Again, these were posted to their website in late August of 2011, but it's unknown when they were uploaded to YouTube as well. On September 15th, 2011, Illusive Entertainment released the highly anticipated fourth episode of A Clone Apart. Episode 4, titled The Unfettered, begins with Boba Fett ordering a drink in the Mos Eisley Cantina, but is suddenly interrupted by a member of the Rebel Alliance, who offers Fett to join them, with Fett immediately declining after the Rebel spy mistakes him for his father. All of a sudden, Danson enters the cantina and orders a Blue Camino, which catches the attention of Fett. Like the Rebel spy before him, Danson mistakes Boba Fett for his father Jango Fett, which only angers him more.
Oh my god, you're Jango Fett! My father! Oh, I have so many questions for you!
You're one of those rotting clones, aren't you?
It's been so difficult! People all tell me I don't fit in.
Now wait a minute,
but
I'm not-
I have this strange feeling that even though we're all copies,
see here, I don't
we
have it.
We have a purpose.
That's enough. I've had a bad enough day without having to hear about yours.
Fett then reveals to Danson that he's just been fired by Jabba the Hutt, after he made a comment about Jabba's weight. Danson then encourages Fett to go back to Jabba and ask for his job back, to which Fett agrees. The episode then jumps to Danson and Fett in Jabba's palace, with a Gamorrean guard guiding them to Jabba. The Gamorrean guard then takes Danson and Fett to the room in Jabba's palace where the droids get tortured, and in the meantime, Fett offers Danson a job to help him hunt down bounties across the galaxy, for which Danson initially declines.
You want to work for me?
Well, I am currently seeking employment. I don't think I'm qualified to take a position that would lead to my untimely demise.
All of a sudden, a guard droid that previously guarded General Grievous during the Clone Wars interrupts Danson and Fett's conversation.
I was built to serve and protect psychopathic villains. After the General was killed and the rest of the droids were to be shut down, I figured someone like Jabba was the next best thing. It pays better as well.
Just then, Fett decides to trick the guard droid into escaping Jabba's palace so that Fett can capture him and win back Jabba.
In fact, I dare say you've never been happy with your station in life. You have your own dreams, and a right to pursue them.
Danson is confused at first, but then gets it and then joins into the conversation, and both of them convince the guard droid to escape to the planet Dagobah. The Gamorrean guard then returns to take Danson and Fett to Jabba, with Danson going in to meet Jabba first. But Danson doesn't fool Jabba into believing that he came alone, as Jabba knows that he had brought Fett with him. All of a sudden, Fett then jetpacks into Jabba's throne room, with an instrumental of the final countdown by Europe playing in the background. Fett then confronts Jabba about he isn't the first person to pick on Jabba's weight, as just moments before, Danson translated that the Gamorrean guard was also just calling him fat. Jabba then understandably gets mad at this, with the Gamorrean guard standing right under Jabba's trapdoor, which Danson mistakenly presses the button to release the trapdoor, with the Gamorrean guard falling down into the Rancor pit.
Jabba! How are you?
Fett then reveals to Jabba that the escaped guard droid fled to Dagobah, with Jabba agreeing to hire Fett back if he captures him, but if he doesn't, then he'll end up in the Rancor pit. Episode 4 then ends there. On October 15, 2011, Illusive Entertainment released Episode 5 of A Clone Apart. The fifth episode, titled Reconnaissance Part 1, begins on the Death Star, with Darth Vader choking Alpha 12's Imperial officer to death, meaning that Alpha 12 will assume his position as commander, for which he's tasked to track down Danson, for which Biff told the Empire that Danson headed off to Alderaan, which is coincidentally going to be destroyed by the Death Star anyways. After Vader leaves, Scout approaches Alpha 12 to say that if Danson gets discharged, then he'll have free compensation provided by the Empire, to which this gives Scout and Alpha 12 further motives to hunt down Danson.
We've lost track of Danson. Well, I can't imagine how this occurred. Do you know what will happen if he attempts to obtain discharge compensation once he figures out we have no intention of allowing him to return to active duty? A soldier who suffers unforeseen temporal relocation is covered by and subject to the full benefits pursuant to the Acts of Force clause outlined in the enlistment papers. Full medical, comp counseling for post-traumatic stress, comprehensive vision and dental, plus PTO for all time displaced. He could bankrupt the entire Empire. And we only indemnify ourselves against accidental expulsion into space or unsolicited consumption by Rancor. Whose bright idea was that? Now I ask you.
Since Alpha 12 is now a commander again, he then promotes Scout to a sergeant.
Don't you think that people calling me Sergeant Scout will be a little cumbersome?
That's no matter. We'll just call you the SS for short.
Huh. Well, I guess that has a nice ring to it.
The episode then cuts to Danson and Boba Fett landing on Dagobah to find Jabba's guard droid.
Wow, my first bounty hunt. This is so much more exciting than going to war.
Keep your voice down.
Oh, sorry. You want me to charge in first and announce that he's under arrest?
Well, that depends. Are you going to give me your rifle?
You mean lend you my rifle, right? Otherwise, I'd be defenseless.
Yes. Right. Lend.
No.
Well, then just stay behind and be my backup.
Once they find the guard droid in the Dagobah swamp, Danson accidentally alerts the droid to their presence, with the guard droid running away with Danson and Fett trying to chase after it. However, Danson falls behind Fett and trips into a cave, for which he gets lost. While Danson is lost in the cave, Fett takes off in the Slave 1, leaving Danson behind on Dagobah. While in the cave, Danson is then approached by Jedi Master Yoda.
Hey, it's my lucky day! I caught a leprechaun!
The episode then cuts back to Alpha 12 and Scout on the Death Star, with Alpha 12 recruiting Biff, Rook, and Teflon McBomb to help them and Scout hunt down Danson. The episode then cuts back to Danson on Dagobah, who is now talking to Yoda.
You guys grant 3 wishes, right? Well, my first is to... Should I ask for my old job back? Maybe with an executive parking space. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Kill you, I would. But a threat? You are not. Intelligence and treachery you lack. Yes, yes.
Yoda then takes Danson back to his hut, with the series making fun of how Yoda was in the prequel trilogy compared to his counterpart in the original trilogy.
I thought all Jedi were strong, fast, powerful, but you're so small and shriveled over.
Osteoporosis, I am. Never again will I be what I was.
Yoda then reveals that Fett has left Dagobah without Danson.
Your friend has left this world and no longer feels his presence, so it matters not what directions I tell you.
You mean... left me? What an asshole!
Ass he may be, but allowed yourself to be left behind you have. An ass you are as well then,
Yoda is then approached by the ghost of Obi-Wan Kenobi, as he has just been slain moments ago by Vader, and is now a Force ghost. Unfortunately, Danson can't communicate with the ghost of Obi-Wan.
Master Yoda, do you have a lazy eye or something? I'm over here.
Worry not, he cannot hear you.
Splendid.
Who can't hear me?
Yoda keeps talking to Obi-Wan, when it's revealed to Danson for the first time that the clone army were the ones who wiped out all the Jedi Knights, which Biff forgot to mention previously. Obi-Wan then convinces Yoda to help Danson get off the planet Dagobah, as Obi-Wan says that Danson will indirectly help Luke Skywalker destroy the first Death Star, with Yoda only agreeing to this under the pretenses that he will never have to see Danson ever again. And like that, Episode 5 ends and cuts to credits. On November 15, 2011, Illusive Entertainment released the sixth episode of A Clone Apart. Episode 6, titled Reconnaissance Part 2, begins with Teflon McBomb interrogating a bartender at Mos Eisley Cantina on the whereabouts of Danson. McBomb then accuses the bartender of racketeering because of all the crimes slash killings that have happened in the cantina throughout the last day.
That's a little convenient, don't you think? One day goes by and all of a sudden all your partners have vanished? You control all profits, all illegal backroom activity.
We don't even have backrooms.
No one to maintain balance, no opposition, no one to stop you from turning this place into a bullfrog brothel and opium den?
What?
That's your insidious plan, isn't it?
Before McBomb finishes his interrogation of the bartender, Alpha 12 then walks into the bar and recruits McBomb to join them in finding Danson in exchange for McBomb's early departure from Tatooine and unlimited supply of government-issued ammunition.
Why would I possibly join up with your little band?
One, because we'll probably leave Tatooine a mite sooner.
Tempting.
Two, Gamma 09 requested you for some reason.
Did he now?
And three, we have an unlimited supply of government-issued ammunition.
Sold! Grun, it looks to be your lucky day.
Good. Come along then.
I'd love to know someone in the galaxy with worse luck than I have.
The episode then cuts to Danson and Yoda walking through Dagobah. Yoda then reveals to Danson that the same power crystals from Utapau that teleported him into the future are the same ones that are being used to power the planet-destroying laser of the Death Star. But the only ship that's available on Dagobah for Danson to fly to the Death Star is a Crash Republic gunship.
That? How the heck am I supposed to fly that?
The episode then cuts back to Alpha 12's assembled squad to hunt down Danson, with Alpha 12 specifically giving the squad instructions to go to Jabba's palace to interrogate him.
Delta 40. A rogue clone who knows the secrets of our Republican past. Secrets so dark, they must be kept out of public knowledge, permanently.
There's nothing wrong with being a Republican, sir.
No, trooper. I mean our past as the Galactic Republic. The betrayal of the Jedi.
In the background, Rook runs off to some Jawas and kills them to upgrade his weapon.
And give it your all.
Yes, sir. Now they will fear us for sure.
That's the spirit, Rook.
Apparently, this was Ryan's favorite part of the series, with him saying on A Clone Apart's FAQ, there's a particular scene in Episode 6 that we really laughed our butts off over, where Rook walks off screen and finally upgrades his weapon. I think it's because of the scream that the Jawas make, which is even better than the Ewok and Gungan screams. For voiceover recording, thus far it's been a blast recording the computer voice with my wife, Yvonne Yao. We always love coming up with new ways for the computer to be evil, or inept given the context of whatever is going on at the time. Anyways, the episode then jumps to Danson and Yoda examining the Crash Republic gunship, which is submerged in water, has a broken engine, and has bent wings.
Looks like you're stuck with me after all, then. You hungry? Let's grab some food.
Absolutely not!
Yoda then lifts the Crash Republic gunship out of the water, similar to what he did for Luke's X-Wing in The Empire Strikes Back, with Yoda instructing Danson to fix the engine with parts from a nearby droid ship. The episode then cuts to Alpha 12 squad questioning Jabba the Hutt on the whereabouts of Danson, to which Jabba tells them that he went looking for an escaped guard droid, but Jabba doesn't remember the planet they went to. Alpha 12 then assumes that Danson is on Geonosis, on a hunch, since that was the clone army's first battle against the droid army. While leaving Jabba's palace to go to Geonosis, Alpha 12 and his squad walk past Boba Fett, who walks in with the captured guard droid. The episode then cuts to Danson piloting the fixed Republic gunship traveling to the Death Star. The episode then cuts back to Alpha 12 and his squad on Geonosis, where there's nothing on the planet, just as Jabba said before.
Well,
amazing find, sir. The weather's even crappier than on Tatooine.
The episode then cuts back to Danson, who is now approaching the Death Star in his gunship. But unfortunately for Danson, the Rebel Alliance is just so happening to stage their attack to blow up the Death Star. And like that, Episode 6 ends and cuts to credits. On December 15, 2011, Illusive Entertainment released the 7th episode of A Clone Apart. Episode 7, titled The Fiery Homecoming, begins with Danson landing into one of the hangars of the Death Star, with Danson having a less than stellar landing.
Stop.
Nansen then exits the gunship and proceeds to walk across the Death Star on foot. We then cut to Alpha 12 and his squad, who are also on the Death Star, after their failed search on Geonosis, with Alpha 12 giving his typical pep talk speech to his squad.
I believe, as long as you believe in me, and what I believe, as opposed to believing the incorrect beliefs that others believe, that we shall triumph.
An Imperial engineer then interrupts Alpha 12's speech, informing them that Danson has arrived on the Death Star.
Will that be all? I'm sort of in the middle of a grand scheme.
I've been ordered by Lord Tarkin to inform everyone. One of the rebels slipped by our defenses in the chaos and has landed inside the station. And he started a fire in Hangar 14! Security says he's disguised in some sort of stylish blue armor that could be mistaken for a stormtrooper's. He could kill us all! Run for your lives! Trust no one!
Well, if he'd said blue clone trooper armor, I'd be alarmed. Come now, let's start arming that pit with mines.
The episode then cuts to Danson exploring the Death Star so he can find the crystals that power the Death Star's laser, but Danson is unfortunately completely lost.
So that's where the bathrooms are. Man, I am totally freaking lost. Come on. You can do it, Trooper. Just relax, focus, and let things flow naturally.
I appreciate the advice, but I really didn't need your help. It's awkward enough trying to use the facilities in this armor.
Danson then mistakenly walks into the detention center, and then gets immediately spotted by Alpha 12 and his crew. Alpha 12 and his squad then proceed to chase down Danson across the Death Star detention center, in a comedic Scooby-Doo-like scene. However, Danson then runs into Teflon McBomb, who fires a rocket almost hitting Danson, with Danson having no choice but to fall down a trash compactor to escape Alpha 12 and his squad. The trash compactor then closes in on Danson, with him only barely escaping it. However, Rook then sees Danson and proceeds to hunt him down, with Danson running into a trap, leaving him nowhere to run. Danson then tells them that all he wanted to do was to go home, which sparks a comedic debate about time travel and multiverse theory, which distracts the squad, leaving Danson the perfect opportunity to escape, with Rook chasing after him.
Come back here, Danson.
While Rook is chasing after Danson, the rest of Alpha 12's squad then sets up mines across the laser of the Death Star, which can only be detonated by unknown threats, which includes Rook as he's the only prototype droid stormtrooper, but not Danson as he's a clone trooper like the rest of Alpha 12's squad. While all of this is happening, the Death Star is about to fire their laser on the rebel base of Yavin 4, which also means that the rebels are about to blow up the Death Star at any given moment. Successfully escaping Rook, Danson then ends up in the room where the laser of the Death Star is located, and coincidentally, Danson happens to just be in time for when the Death Star's laser is shooting. Danson then jumps into the laser of the Death Star, for which he is magically teleported out of the Death Star. Then Rook comes out of the same place where Danson escaped from, which triggers one of the mines that was set up in the Death Star's laser room, with the explosion from the mines sending the whole squad into the firing laser of the Death Star, teleporting them exactly how Danson was.
I am so dizzy.
The squad is then teleported to a mysterious base on a snowy planet, which of course turns out to be the rebel base of Hoth, with the Death Star laser also teleporting the whole squad 3 years into the future. And like that, episode 7 ends on a cliffhanger, and cuts to credits. On January 15th, 2012, Illusive Entertainment released the 8th and final episode of A Clone Apart Season 1. Episode 8, titled New Time, Colder Place, begins with Alpha 12 and his squad in the Hoth Rebel base, 3 years into the future, reflecting on what exactly just happened to them.
Well, given the terrain, I think it's safe to assume we're in hell, thanks to that scrap pile over there.
Downcast expression, I have decreased in value.
Sir, even assuming that a place such as hell exists, which is still being vigorously debated across every planet in the Empire, it's highly unlikely that this is it.
Do you have a better theory, Sergeant?
I must redeem myself.
Alpha 12 then decides to split the group up, with Alpha 12 and Scout exploring the outside of the base, while Biff, McBomb, and Rook explore the inside of the base. Once the squad is split up, Rook detects Danson is hiding behind a box in the base, revealing that he too has been transported to Hoth with Alpha 12's squad. When Biff, McBomb, and Rook find Danson hiding behind a box, he is freezing due to the cold temperature of Hoth's atmosphere.
Why
everywhere.
However, Biff then instructs Danson on how to turn the heater on in his clone trooper armor.
What a surprise! Blue button. I think it's working. Oh god, now it's hot!
Yeah, it'll even out in a bit.
Once Danson turns his armor heater on, he, Biff, McBomb, and Rook decide to work together on where they exactly are. The episode then cuts to Alpha 12 and Scout exploring the base, for which they encounter a rebel, discovering that they are now on a rebel base. Scout and Alpha 12 explore the base some more, where they find a room with a computer terminal, which they use to communicate with an Imperial spy. The Imperial spy reveals that they are now on the planet Hoth and it's been 3 years since they disappeared. The Imperial spy then says that the Empire will shortly be landing on Hoth with AT-AT walkers, and instructs Alpha 12 and Scout to help destroy the base's shield generator.
Sir, I no longer think it's premature to say, I told you so.
The episode then cuts back to Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rook exploring Hoth, but while running they encounter a trench, for which Danson falls and trips into, splitting up the group even more.
Guys? Will someone help me out of here?
Before Danson can get a chance to get out, a rebel spy catches Danson. This rebel spy's name is Colonel Vespa, and was the same rebel who offered Boba Fett a job in the Rebel Alliance in the cantina from episode 4. Danson then compliments Vespa on her looks, as this is apparently the first woman that Danson has ever seen.
Hey, I hope you don't mind me saying this, because I've never had the opportunity to say this to anyone before, but you're kinda pretty.
Excuse me?
I'm sorry. I really haven't met any ladies, now that I think of it, since I woke up on Kamino.
Vespa then reveals to Danson that the Death Star was destroyed by the Rebels 3 years ago. Vespa is then interrupted by a fellow Rebel commander informing her that he has seen two other Imperial stormtroopers roaming around the Rebel base. This distraction gives Danson the perfect time to successfully escape.
Well, my blue-trimmed friend? Inform the princess that we have been breached. Have all available ground troops meet me in the trenches.
Sure thing, ma'am.
Intriguing. Why is he dressed like a clone?
The episode then jumps to the rebels fighting off the AT-AT walkers and snowtroopers of the Empire. A shot then shows Alpha 12 and Scout on the top of a nearby rebel base building, with them spotting the base's shield generator. After some hesitation by Scout, both he and Alpha 12 charge to the shield generator to disable it, while the Battle of Hoth is still brewing. The episode then cuts to Danson, who finds Biff, McBomb, and Rook on one of the snowy hills. Danson then reveals to Biff, McBomb, and Rook that they have traveled 3 years into the future and that the rebels have blown up the Death Star.
What a bummer. I know. I'm sorry, guys. This was supposed to just be for me. I didn't mean to drag all of you along.
You didn't. Rook did. He blew us all into the laser stream by accident.
Really? I thought he was smarter than all of us put together.
While it is technically accurate, it wasn't me who planted mines and dead packs that weren't attuned to the frequency of my prototype suit. That person was a jackass.
Did you just call Alpha a jackass?
If the shoe fits, Danson.
The episode then cuts back to Alpha 12 and Scout, who have traversed through the dangerous battlefield into a small base that has a terminal, which Scout accesses. Unfortunately for Scout, the terminal that he accesses is in Mandalorian, which is a language that Scout doesn't speak.
You can figure it out, SS. You're a science officer.
That doesn't make me an expert in languages, sir.
No, but it does mean you can hack the computer to change the display language.
Sir, science and computer science are not mutually inclusive. And anyway, I've sat behind a desk playing Flibble Bobble for most of the last 2 decades.
Alpha 12 then threatens Scout to just hack the terminal, even though it's non-hackable due to the language barrier. The episode then cuts to Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rook on the hill, debating on what the Empire will do to them since they've been missing for 3 years.
Does anyone find it funny that the robot can kill civilians indiscriminately, but needs permission to attack a military target?
Well said.
Plus, obviously we can't just head back to the military after being missing for 3 years. They'll court-martial a lot of us, or maybe just throw us out an airlock.
Or both.
I do not respire, and thus do not need oxygen. No biggie.
Yeah,
Yes, Biggie.
The episode then jumps back to Scout hacking the terminal, to which he successfully hacks it, disabling the shield generator, which explodes immediately after the hacking. Alpha 12 then proclaims that he might be promoted again after the shield generator disabling, for which Scout corrects him by bringing up the fact that they were just missing for 3 years. But then an announcement is made by an Empire soldier that General Veers has taken credit for disabling the generator, meaning that neither Scout nor Alpha 12 will be getting the credit. The episode then cuts back to Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rook on the hill, debating on whether being a soldier is the right position for Danson.
I don't think I'm cut out for this whole military thing.
My career advice subroutine strongly suggests that you consider a future in hospitality management.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Really?
You'd fit in better there, since you obviously don't know how to use a rifle.
I've never seen you use a rifle either.
I still kill things.
But all of a sudden, a Wampa is seen in the background, with the whole episode ending on the Wampa attacking Danson. The episode then cuts to black with the "to be continued" text, and then transitions into the traditional credits. And like that, both episode 8 and season 1 of A Clone Apart come to a close. But after the end credits of episode 8 comes a little trailer for season 2. This trailer for season 2 was also included at the end of all the credits for the previous episodes, even going back to the 2006 releases of the first 3 episodes. So it's safe to assume that during the release of all these episodes, Illusive Entertainment was still working on the second season when they were doing the first. Or maybe they had season 2 completed the whole time while season 1 was airing online. Still though, all of this is unknown, and all we have to base the second season on is this very trailer. Technically, there are 2 trailers for season 2, with the first one actually being a trailer that combines upcoming scenes of season 1 with season 2. You'll see what I'm talking about in just a second. This was the trailer that also played at the end of all the previous 7 episodes of season 1, as well as this trailer being viewable separately on Illusive Entertainment's website, as well as being viewable on Ryan James' personal YouTube channel. It's possible that some of these shots from season 2 could have been planned for season 1, and that some of season 2's episodes were originally planned for season 1, but again, this is all just speculation. The second trailer for season 2 was solely focused on the footage that was shot for the second season, with this version only appearing at the end of episode 8. This trailer basically has the same footage as the first trailer does, but instead of showing the first half, which is basically a trailer for season 1, it just jump cuts to the footage that's present in season 2, if that makes any sense at all. The only footage that's missing from the second trailer that was presumably going to be in the second season is this shot of Darth Vader towering over Alpha 12 demanding that he find Danson. So after all that, let's talk about the trailer for season 2. It starts off with Danson singing the Vespa, on what appears to be the planet Renvar, with Danson singing over Marion's theme from Raiders of the Lost Ark, which was of course also composed by John Williams. But then Biff interrupts them.
Shut up! People are trying to sleep! For the love of—
And the rest of the trailer is just short footage and side jokes taken from season 2, including a scene of Danson, Biff, McBomb, Rook, and Awampa on Mustafar, with a clone trooper engineer and 2 rebel engineers in the background. A scene of Naboo with a group of Gungans and a clone trooper commander of sorts, with Scout in the background. A scene of Vespa and Wookiee guard shooting at stormtroopers in Paulus Massa. A scene where Biff and a Wookiee guard race speeder bikes on Kashyyyk. A miscellaneous scene of Rook destroying what appears to be part of a Star Destroyer in space, and a scene of Danson, Biff, McBomb, Rook, and Awampa being confronted by Wookiee guards on Hoth. And for almost a decade, this is the only footage that was ever publicly released for season 2 of A Clone Apart, as to this day, Illusive Entertainment has never released season 2. And for almost a decade, fans of A Clone Apart have been asking the same question. Why hasn't season 2 been released? Well, I did my research, and this is what I found. So as we all know, the season finale for A Clone Apart Season 1 aired on the internet on January 15th, 2012. But a month prior, on December 10th, 2011, Naughty Dog would announce their new game at the Spike Video Game Awards, The Last of Us. For The Last of Us, Ryan James would be the lead editor for the game, something that took a lot of time away from A Clone Apart, since The Last of Us had a huge expansive story that was arguably the sole focus of the game. For the next 3.5 years, Ryan would be one of the main editors for the story, and in October of 2012, Illusive Entertainment's website would display this message, saying their website is under construction and that a clone of Part will be back, but they weren't allowed to say how soon. I'm guessing that this message on their website and also this sentence from their "We're Back" announcement is probably why those lawsuit rumors were started. Illusive Entertainment would say that Season 2 would come out on December 1st, 2012, but this release date was never met. On January 29th, 2013, Illusive Entertainment updated their website for the final time. Well, the final message I was able to find archived, saying this. I suppose that's obvious if you're reading this, but we're active again so y'all can watch a Clone Apart episodes and the like. Hooray! One note though. The forums have been deactivated. They were part of the reason the site went down in the first place, so it's good that they're gone. Welcome back everyone, sorry for the delay. In other news, ACA is still in its season hiatus as Ryan wraps up his work on The Last of Us, which comes out May 7th. ACA work can't be resumed until then, sorry to say, but making video games is hard. Sometime in 2016 or 2017, Illusive Entertainment's website would shut down, and ever since then, the URL now takes you to a 503 service unavailable message. On June 14th, 2013, The Last of Us was released to critical praise, with many critics saying that it had perhaps the greatest story that a video game had ever told up to that point, and was arguably a major breakthrough in the video game industry in general, especially since it was one of the last games to be released for the 7th generation of consoles. DLC would also come out on February 14th, 2014, and a PS4 remaster of the game would be released on July 29th, 2014. On November 24th, 2013, Ryan gave an interview with journalist Forrest Bizot, to which many of the questions were either about The Last of Us or news about a clone apart, to which Bizot asked, "Can you say anything about what ACA fans can expect to see in Season 2? Well, first, I should say that if there's any fans left after this second hiatus, we're grateful for the patience. Making The Last of Us took 3.5 years, and after the first year-ish, during which I released the rest of ACA Season 1, I realized I was just too exhausted for Moonlight editing, the series after a full day's work editing The Last of Us. So the series had been waiting for me to be done. Now The Last of Us is done, though the single player DLC we're making is still taking my time. But never fear, it'll be over soon. That being said, the biggest thing we have in store for fans is, all I can say is it's my favorite thing we've ever wanted to do on the show. It beats Rook killing the Jawa, Alpha 12's belief speech, and even the Scooby-Doo-like sequence in the Death Star prison block, all of which are my other favorite bits we've ever done. If you want a hint, look at the shot in the trailer that involves fireworks. Now, if we can only get the recording needed for that section to happen, that'll be the real trick, as it requires efforts we've never had to go to before. Once that recording has happened, and I know we're solid, then and only then I will be able to confidently announce that the series' last season can come to the light of day. After The Last of Us was released, Naughty Dog would start work on their next game, which was the fourth installment in the Uncharted franchise, that being Uncharted 4: A Thief's End, for which Ryan James would be the lead editor just like he was with The Last of Us. This also probably took more time away from A Clone Apart, as Uncharted 4 wasn't released till May 10th, 2016. After Uncharted 4, Naughty Dog would soon start work on Uncharted: The Lost Legacy, which was a collection of the previous three installments of the Uncharted franchise, porting them over to the PS4, as well as a sequel to The Last of Us, which was The Last of Us Part 2. For The Last of Us Part 2, Ryan would again be an editor on the game, being credited as lead gameplay voice direction, as well as being credited as an additional writer. And for now, that's pretty much all I could find about Ryan's whereabouts in recent years, as his Twitter and Facebook accounts haven't really given us any further news about A Clone Apart. And I don't think I need to say this, but don't go and harass Ryan on his personal accounts about information on A Clone Apart. Again, I don't think this goes without saying, but just don't do that. Are we good? Okay then. But for now, Ryan's 2013 interview is the last update for A Clone Apart from Ryan directly, or at least the last time he addressed A Clone Apart publicly. But that isn't the end of the story when it comes to the rumors about A Clone Apart, as we now have to talk about Alpha Nova. So as we all know, A Clone Apart came back in mid-2011, but other YouTube channels would re-upload Illusive Entertainment's work following YouTube taking down the original uploads for A Clone Apart's episodes. To this day, official uploads of these episodes from Illusive Entertainment don't exist today at all, so the only way to experience these episodes again is through re-uploads, with one of these re-upload channels being Alpha Nova, whose uploads are currently the most viewed on YouTube, and is probably how you and I discovered the series in the first place. But aside from his re-uploads, Alpha Nova has also posted update videos on the whereabouts of when Season 2 will come out. It's unknown who Alpha Nova even is, but with these video updates, he seems to have taken as the original creator of A Clone Apart, or at least is highly connected in the making of the show. However, his editing style and manner of speaking definitely say otherwise, as these videos look like they were edited by a child who happened to be a fan of the series. Regardless, on July 28, 2014, Alpha Nova posted an update video on A Clone Apart, stating that the series would probably never continue because Lucasfilm was suing them, which of course wasn't true. But in the current day uploaded this video, the title was changed by adding "not true anymore" in brackets. On February 15, 2015, Alpha Nova would upload a trailer edit for Star Wars Episode 4 New Hope, with him updating the video description to give viewers updates on A Clone Apart, saying that A Clone Apart isn't dead but he doesn't know when the series is coming out, though he assures his audience that Season 2 will have the same amount of episodes as Season 1. On August 26, 2015, Alpha Nova would upload a trailer edit of The Last of Us, with him updating the video description to give updates on A Clone Apart, saying that Season 2 will come out a year from now as soon as Ryan finishes work on Uncharted 4. On March 17, 2016, Alpha Nova would upload a video called "People Are Awesome," which is an edit of humans achieving impressive feats, with him assuring in the description that A Clone Apart will continue when Ryan finishes work on Uncharted 4. On April 29, 2016, Alpha Nova would upload a video titled "Where is A Clone Apart?" In it, Alpha Nova states that Ryan posted something new on the Illusive Entertainment website, saying that he is truly sorry for no news on the second season, and explaining where it's been this whole time. I couldn't find the post on the archived website itself, so all we have to go off of is this video. Alpha Nova then claims that Ryan said that the filming for the scenes are done, but the script, voice acting, and editing aren't, though Ryan also says that he wants to finish the series. On December 14, 2016, Alpha Nova would upload a CSGO montage called "Why No Fundraiser for ACA," to which the description seems to be a copy-paste section from Illusive Entertainment's website, more specifically their FAQ section, which I was unable to access via Internet Archive. The post reads, "Why no fundraiser for ACA?" To which Ryan responds, "As much as I like that, I think we'd get in trouble if we were fundraising. If any medium slash big money were to change hands or anything, Disney's lawyers would be all over us. Thanks for your patience and support thus far. We will eventually put out this second and final season. Yes, we will return. The when is hazy. Those last two games in a row took up a major ton of my personal and professional time, so it will take some time, possibly most of this year, for me to get those sorted out enough that I have time to dedicate to the final season of ACA. As I've said to everyone else, thanks for your patience thus far." On March 28, 2017, Alpha Nova would upload a CSGO gameplay video titled, "What Should I Do?" More info in the description, where he says he doesn't know when Season 2 is coming out, as he doesn't actually have contact with the creators of the series. On January 20th, 2018, Alpha Nova would post an update for A Clone Apart for the final time, essentially repeating the same thing that he said in the last CSGO gameplay. And for now, that is currently the last traces of where Season 2 of A Clone Apart is today. But that doesn't mean we can't speculate on what Season 2 would've and could've been. Due to the Season 2 trailer, we still have a general, if not cryptic, idea of where Season 2 would've gone. So here's my general prediction of how this season would play out, at least according to the trailer clips. So as we all know, Season 1 ended with Danson getting attacked by a Wampa on the planet Hoth. But in the trailer, this same Wampa seems to be accompanying Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rourke on later scenes on Hoth, as well as these scenes on Mustafar. So maybe the Wampa accompanies Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rourke later in the story. Or maybe it's just another friendly Wampa in general. During the trailer, there's also these shots of Darth Vader confronting Alpha 12 on finding Danson, to which there's also footage of Alpha 12 commanding fellow stormtroopers to hunt down Danson, which further establishes that Alpha 12 is hell-bent on capturing Danson even more than he was in the first season. There's also this scene of Danson, Biff, McBomb, and Rourke in a Wampa being confronted by Wookiee guards in a Rebel hangar base on Hoth, with the trailer also showing footage of Biff and a Wookiee guard riding on speeder bikes on the planet Kashyyyk, which is the home planet of the Wookiee species. So maybe these Wookiees take Danson, Biff, McBomb, Rourke, and the Wampa to Kashyyyk, and maybe then they go to Mustafar, since the Wampa is also still present with them. During their trip to Mustafar, they get confronted by a clone engineer. So either this character time traveled like Danson did, or just rebelled against the Republic after they became the Empire. Or maybe it's just a Mustafar engineer that happens to have the same model as a clone engineer. There's also, of course, this footage of Danson singing the Vespa, which implies a possible romance between the characters in Season 2. This scene also takes place on the planet Renvar, which was an Xbox-exclusive DLC map, with Biff also interrupting them, which could also mean that McBomb, Rook, and maybe even the Wampa might also be present there too. There's also these scenes on Naboo where a clone trooper character who was also seen in this A Clone Apart poster. This clone trooper is interestingly wearing Phase 1 armor, which could mean that this clone trooper could be a time traveler like Danson was, or is a rogue clone trooper entirely. Also, Scout is seen in the background for these shots in Naboo, suggesting that he and maybe even Alpha 12 go to Naboo at some point in the season. And finally, there's a scene of Vespa and some Wookiee guards shooting at stormtroopers on the planet Paulus Massa, so they probably go to that planet in the season as well. Anyways, the definite story beats of the second season that I'm willing to bet are accurate is that after Danson gets attacked by the Wampa, Biff, McBomb, and Rook probably tame the Wampa, or something like that, and they become friends, to which they then decide to fly off of Hoth to escape Alpha 12 and the rest of the Empire, but are then confronted by Wookiee guards in the hangar, to which they probably have a beef at first, but then they make friends with them. And then they go to either Kashyyyk or Mustafar, and then from there the plot is pretty much undeterminable, other than the certain plot beats and other shots that were teased in the trailer like the planets, characters, or certain comedic scenarios. But for now, all these speculations I've just made are all we have to work on for what Season 2 of A Clone Apart would have been, as for almost a decade, A Clone Apart Season 2 has yet to be released, with the last updates on where the season has been being almost half a decade old. In 2007, game studios Free Radical Design, with publisher LucasArts, would start developing Star Wars Battlefront 3 for PC, Xbox 360, PS3, and even the Wii, with LucasArts announcing the game around mid-2007 with these trailers that show on foot and aerial combat at the same time, which was as revolutionary as it was mind-blowing. The game was later heavily teased in 2008, most notably showing a trailer which teased the upcoming and improved campaign, which told an original story in the Star Wars universe. But for one reason or another, LucasArts would pull the rights for the Star Wars franchise from Free Radical Design, meaning that the game would be cancelled indefinitely, as LucasArts was going through some financial difficulties, and didn't want to spend more money on making an expensive game that would take up time and resources to make in the first place. What could have been not only the greatest Star Wars game ever made, but also one of the best games of the 7th generation of consoles was cancelled just like that. However, the remnants of Star Wars Battlefront 3 live on in fan mods, in Battlefront 2, and leaked official prototypes of the early game builds. In 2013, following Disney's acquisition of Lucasfilm, Electronic Arts would obtain the exclusive rights to develop future Star Wars games. Game Studio DICE, a subsidiary of EA, and the current developers of the popular Battlefield franchise of games, would be tasked with making a reboot to the Battlefront franchise. In June of 2013, DICE would release an announcement teaser trailer, and in April of 2015, they would release another teaser showing the cinematics of the game. Me personally, I was pretty excited when both of these trailers were released, but I braced myself for if the game was going to get cancelled just like Battlefront 3 did. During E3 of 2015, DICE would reveal the first gameplay trailer for their Battlefront reboot, with the gameplay being centered around the planet Hoth. I remember when this trailer first dropped. It was an early morning and I had to go to school. I was probably around like 10 or 11 years old, and I just decided to open up YouTube on my phone. And I was just utterly amazed and excited with this new gameplay trailer. I was a huge Star Wars fan at the time, and I was just so excited that a new Battlefront game would be coming out after all these years. That following summer, I would save up money to buy an Xbox One just so I could play Star Wars Battlefront, along with Black Ops 3 and Halo 5 on the next generation of consoles. On November 17, 2015, EA's Star Wars Battlefront was released, and it kinda disappointed not only me, but also the broader gaming community in general. The main complaint with EA's Battlefront was that it had very little content, as this Battlefront game only focused on the original trilogy, and omitted the prequel trilogy, as well as there being no campaign. EA would further piss off gamers when they announced that Battlefront would be coming out with a season pass that contained DLC for more maps, for a whopping price of $40, on top of the $60 that gamers had to pay for the base game, meaning that you would have to pay $100 for essentially the whole game. Naturally, this pissed off many in the gaming community, including myself, who thought they were being ripped off for a game that, even with all the DLC, still had less content compared to the previous installment released over a decade prior. However, all this fan outrage wouldn't hit its ultimate peak until EA released Star Wars Battlefront 2 on November 17th, 2017. On the surface, EA's Battlefront 2 seemed like a drastic improvement from its predecessor, with this game having both the original trilogy, the prequel trilogy, and the sequel trilogy playable, with way more maps than before, with EA saying that they would make additional DLC maps and characters as free updates instead of the much-hated season pass. And this game would also have a single-player campaign that the previous one lacked. However, all these improvements couldn't make up for EA's major downgrade when it came to Star Wars Battlefront 2, which was its pay-to-win mechanics. You see, EA's Battlefront 2 would implement the use of Star Cards, which were basically like perks in a Call of Duty game, that you can further upgrade by having a better advantage in multiplayer. However, instead of grinding endlessly to obtain and upgrade these cards, Battlefront 2 would implement the use of microtransactions that gave players a chance to essentially gamble real-life money on loot crates to obtain rare and upgraded Star Cards without grinding for them. To say that this caused a controversy would be a huge understatement. The negative feedback that EA got from Battlefront 2's microtransaction loot boxes were so bad that the Belgian, Australian, Singapore, and American governments threatened to investigate EA on the grounds that these mechanics were considered illegal gambling. Though these mechanics of loot boxes were already present in games like Overwatch, CSGO, later Call of Duty installments, Rocket League, TF2, League of Legends, and previous EA sports game franchises, EA's Battlefront 2 was the first time that everybody came together in the gaming community and collectively said that this was complete and utter bullshit, and review bombs would soon follow on sites like Metacritic, leading EA's market share value to drop by 2.5%, which was over $3 billion in stock value. EA would have no choice but to temporarily, and later fully remove all microtransactions from the game. After removing the microtransactions, EA would solely focus on rebuilding Battlefront 2 to a more balanced and playable experience. As for the next 2 to 3 years, DICE would constantly update the game, with these updates pretty much saving the game. Though at launch, Battlefront 2 was pretty bad, the updated version was actually a really fun and amazing experience and became one of my favorite shooters of this generation of gaming. And I'm not alone on this, since when DICE was updating the game, the player base would come back and form a strong community online, making for one of the best video game comebacks in recent memory. On April 29th, 2020, DICE would release their final update for Battlefront 2, in which DICE would move on to other things, possibly a Battlefront 3 in the future. Though the future for the Star Wars Battlefront franchise seems endless, the future for a clone apart seems pretty bleak. I still have hope that one day a Clone Apart Season 2 will be released, but deep down inside, I know it's probably never gonna happen. But as it stands today, Season 2 of A Clone Apart has yet to be released, and it may stay that way for the rest of time. It's a shame because who knows what the series would have accomplished later in its lifespan. Though it wasn't by any means a perfect series, A Clone Apart was one of the best machinimas both at the time and even to this day, but maybe it could have been so much more. Fans of the series have been waiting for almost a decade for this second season, but I guess we'll never know. And for now, that's the complete story of A Clone Apart, the best machinima series that never was. Thank you for watching.